Thank you, Karen. I was watching Karen to see when she would look up like this at me. That's my signal. Good morning to you all. It is a good morning. Welcome, welcome to this place. A place where we come to worship, to hear, maybe be taught. At this stage in life, how many of us are teachable? To see and to interact with each other. It's all good. So I welcome you this morning to this place and to all of the things that we will be doing. And we welcome the people who have joined us electronically. We wish you could, we could see you. We wish we could talk directly to you, but you're welcome to be with us today. If you have an announcement, would you come up right now?
Morning, everybody. So I'm making an announcement for Cynthia because she's not able to be here today to make it herself. There's going to be a new Sunday school class exploring the Enneagram, which is a way of kind of understanding your personality. And there's a book that she's interested in studying that looks at that from a spiritual perspective. So if you are interested in the class, there's going to be an initial session just to gauge that interest in the library next Sunday during the Sunday school hour. And Cynthia will talk more about what that class will be, and you can kind of make a decision on whether it's something you're interested in. And you can read a little bit more. There's a little blurb in the bulletin. And if you have questions, you can ask me, but I'll probably just pass you on to Cynthia because she's the one that is kind of organizing this. So, thanks.
Okay, hi. My name's Eva, and this is my sister, Lucy. And we're planning on going to Bolivia in March. If you also plan on going to Bolivia, can you please stand up? I think a lot of people are in the kitchen right now, so it's just Josh, but thank you, you can sit down now. We have three fundraisers for this trip. The first one is actually today, and it's a baked potato bar after church. We have lots of toppings and chili to put on your potato. And we also have pumpkin cake with cream cheese frosting. And then, the second fundraiser that we're doing is the holiday resale. We are taking orders until the first week of November. They're $40 each. They're freshly made by Juana Cortez. They will be ready for pickup the Sunday before Thanksgiving. And the last fundraiser is the fall yard cleanup. This is happening November 9th and 11th. You can sign up in the foyer or contact one of the people going to Bolivia.
Okay. Thank you for helping with getting us to Bolivia.
In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man named Joseph of the house of David. And this virgin's name was Mary. He went in and he said to her, "Rejoice, so highly favored, the Lord is with you." She was deeply disturbed by these words and asked herself what the meaning could be. But the angel said to her, "Mary, don't be afraid. You have won God's favor. Listen. You are to conceive and bear a son, and you must name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High." It's a promise. The theme today is promises made, promises broken. Steve's going to tell us how to tell the difference between truth and falsehood today. Right? Well, as this election season winds down or up, however you want to say it, we hear a lot of promises. Somebody said this week, we are in the golden age of lies. Never before have we been so free to lie to one another. Never before have we had more media, more means for spreading lies. So, what do we believe? Who is reliable? Well, I believe God is reliable. But the challenge for me is figuring out what has God promised. We hear a lot about promises. Reminded me of a song we used to sing. It's in the old Life song. It goes like this. God has not promised sky's always blue, flower-strewn pathways all our lives through. God has not promised sun without rain, joy without sorrow, peace without pain. God has not promised we shall not know toil and temptation, trouble and woe. He hath not told us that we shall not bear many a burden, many a care. God hath not promised smooth roads and wide, swift, easy travel, needing no guide. Never a mountain rocky or steep, never a river turbid and deep. And some of you could probably help me sing the refrain. But God hath promised strength for the day, rest for the labor, light for the way, grace for the trials, help from above, unfailing sympathy, undying love. Promises of God. Clyde, let's see.
I was struggling a bit this last week, looking at 2 Samuel 7, 1 to 17, trying to figure out how does that relate to our songs for this week. 3 o'clock this morning, I finally had some answers. I do that all the time. In 2 Samuel 7, you see a picture of God relating to his people. That's what I think that chapter is about. Okay, let's turn to Numbers 47. And if you're able, would you stand with me? Number 47, God of our strength.
God of our strength, enthroned above, the source of life, the fount of love, O that devotion
Number 62. God is here among us.
God is here among us, come with adoration, fervent praise and expectation. God is here within us, known beyond believing, soul in silent awe receiving. God will make and will claim those he held as lowly, making all things holy. Come abide within us, let my soul like Mary be thy earthly sanctuary. Come indwelling Spirit with transfigured splendor, love and honor will I render. Where I go here below, let me bow before thee, know thee and adore thee.
You may be seated. Would you join me in blessing the offerings today? There's an offering box here, and there's one in the foyer. Lord God, we are grateful, we are thankful for your blessings to us. Everything we are and have comes to us from you. And we bring back just a small portion of that as an offering today. Pray that you will bless each one of them. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and pass peace and blessings to one another. Thank you.
The next song that I chose for today is number 703. And I chose it not totally because of the rain that we've had, but the words of the verses on the second page. And take a look at those words as we sing it. Karen's going to play it with us, and let's stand. Rain down, rain down. Let's do that one again. Thank you, Karen. Number 419. If there is a song that really hits the meaning of the relationship between God and his people. It's great is thy faithfulness. 419.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassion, they fail not. As thou hast sinned, forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness.
Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy.
Number 101.
Sing praise to God, who still to God and praise and glory.
Come on up, kids, and we are going to start with a song, so you guys can help me with the motions or help hold the sign. Owen and Wyatt, could you go grab that yellow sign? Oh, thanks, Jack. And this song was a request from Soli Amstutz. It's My God Is So Big. We've been talking some about God's promises, and I want you to be thinking, what does this story have to do with God's promises? I have some ideas, but I'd like to hear your guys' ideas at the end, and then we can share, okay? Y'all in a good place to see? All right. Now, something's a little different about this story. The main character is a rock. Stone, rock. All right, here we go. It's called A Stone Sat Still. A stone sat still with the water, grass, and dirt. And it was as it was, where it was in the world. And the stone was dark. And the stone was bright. And the stone was loud. Sat where it sat with the water, grass, and dirt, and it was as it was where it was in the world. And the stone was rough. And the stone was smooth. And the stone was green, red, purple, and blue. And the stone was a pebble. And the stone was a hill. And the stone was a feel. And the stone was a smell. See the moose and the fox? And it sat where it sat, with the water, grass, and dirt. And it was as it was, where it was in the world. And the stone was the wild. And the stone was a home. And the stone was a kitchen. A fish kitchen. And the stone was a throne. And the stone was a marker and a map and a maze. A danger. A haven. A story. A stage. And the stone. And the stone was a blink. And the stone was an age. Love, water spilling up around it. And the stone was an island. And the stone was a wave. Where's the stone? And the stone was a memory. Seem kind of imaginary here. And the stone was always. What do you notice about the ways here? Have you ever known such a place? Where with water, grass, and dirt. Do you notice anything different about this? A stone. Oops, I skipped a picture. Where with water, grass, and dirt. A stone sits still in the world. All right, so what do you think this story could have to do with God? Does anyone have any ideas? Hila?
Special to him.
The world is special to him. The stone might be special to him. Sure. All right. You have a question.
Love is always.
Kind of like the picture that said in the stone was always. I think that's a great connection. Well, let me share a little bit about what I was thinking. And we'll say a prayer and go back to this. Oh, thank you.
It's everything.
All right. Well, sometimes God can be kind of like the stone in this story because God is always there. God is always there for us. And it can be lots of things, right? God can be a haven. God can be our friend. God can be someone we talk to when we're scared. God can be someone we celebrate with when we're happy. But God's always there, and that's God's promise to us. Just like the song Ken talked about earlier. Doesn't mean there won't be times that are scary, or dark, or cold. But God is always there. So that's what I want us to remember. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for the beautiful world around us. Nature that lives outdoors, and we thank you, Lord, that you're like the rock for us, and you're always there. In your name we pray. Amen. Back to your seats.
Thank you, Seth. Scripture reading this morning is from the second book of Samuel, and I'm going to start with the first verse. Once David had settled into his house, and Yahweh had given him rest from all the enemies that surrounded him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "Look, I'm living in a house of cedar, while the ark of God dwells in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go and do all that is on your mind, for Yahweh is with you." But that very night, the word of Yahweh came to Nathan. "Go and tell my servant David, thus Yahweh speaks, are you the man to build me a house to dwell in? I've never stayed in a house from the day that I brought the Israelites out of Egypt until today. But I've always led a wanderer's life in a tent. In all my journeying with the whole people of Israel, did I say to any one of the judges of Israel whom I had appointed as shepherds of Israel, my people, why have you not built me a house of cedar? This is what you must say to my servant David. Yahweh Sabaoth says this, I took you from the pasture, from following sheep, to be a leader of my people Israel. I've been with you on all your expeditions. I have cut off all your enemies before you, and I will give you fame as great as the fame of the greatest on the earth. I will provide a place for my people Israel. I will plant them there, and they will dwell in that place and never be disturbed again. Nor will the wicked continue to oppress them as they did in the days when I appointed judges over them. I will give them rest from all their enemies. Yahweh will make you great. Yahweh will make you a house. And when your days are ended and you're laid to rest with your ancestors, I will preserve the offspring of your body after you, and I will make his sovereign secure. It is he who will build a house for my name, and I will make his royal throne secure forever. I will be a father to him, and he will be a son to me. If he does evil, I will punish him with the rod such as men use, with strokes such as mankind gives. Yet I will not withdraw my favor from him as I withdrew it from your predecessor. Your house and your sovereignty will always stand secure before me, and your throne will be established forever." And Nathan related all these words to David, and this whole revelation.
The Lord be with you. So promises. David makes promises. God makes promises as well. So we're moving into this time period of kings for this ancient Hebrew people as we trace this story. The first king was King Saul. I briefly mentioned him last week. This week's passage deals with the beginning of King David's reign. David, probably the most famous king during this ancient time, but instead of focusing so much on David, instead of focusing on really any of the stories of David that made him so well known, I want to pull back. I want to call our attention to one of the larger themes throughout this whole story, and it's going on here in this passage. Moving through God's story, we've already identified one theme, the theme of the outsider, the alien, how God hears the cry of the oppressed, and how God desires that God's people would hear the cry of the oppressed as well and welcome them. It's the theme of Passover as an antidote to cruelty. That theme should come to mind when we hear references like, "I am the God that brought you out of Egypt." Caring for those on the margins, it's a theme that Jesus taps into as well. He taps into that as he reads scripture in the synagogue at the beginning of his public ministry. Scripture from Isaiah says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. He has sent me to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim the release of the prisoners and recovery of sight to the blind, to liberate the oppressed." So this morning's text, though, it comes from 2 Samuel and invites us to focus on another major theme of Scripture, the theme of power, God's presence in weakness. Samuel tells us about an interaction between King David and Nathan serving as messenger of God to the people, and this interaction sort of between the three of them and Nathan being the mouthpiece. So David has recently come into power as king, and to express David's thanks for all that God has done for him, King David tells Nathan to tell God that he's going to build a mighty house for God. King David says, "I'm living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." The theme of power might not immediately jump out, but it's not so different from what we see and do today. See, about 30 minutes down the street from us, south on I-5, is the city of Salem. The capital of the state of Oregon, in Salem, the capital city, there is a capital building. We used to live in Salem, and I drove by the Capitol building often, sometimes multiple times in the same day. Drove by it enough to get used to the confusing one-way streets on either side. The Capitol building, it's easily recognizable. It's topped with a big concrete cylinder, and on top of that is the man, the golden pioneer. Washington State, its capital, has an even more profound effect, I think. As you head north on I-5 and you're heading out of Tumwater into Olympia, if you look at just the right moment on a clear day, you can catch a glimpse of the Washington State Capitol off in the distance next to Capitol Lake. With its massive dome and Roman columns beneath that, these Capitol buildings and others like them across the United States, they're recognized as the seat of power for states. There's another seat of power in Washington, D.C., called the White House. If you haven't heard, it's up for grabs because apparently there's an election happening. These are more than just buildings, though. See, we associate these important buildings with power and authority because inside these buildings is where those with power and authority conduct their business. The seat of power. It's called the seat of power not because there's an actual piece of furniture that's imbued with beyond normal strength, but because of those who occupy these spaces. Governors, state legislatures, Congress, presidents, it's the people in the buildings, it's the business that they're about that makes these the seat of power. During ancient Bible times, it was the same thing, or just a little bit differently, though. Large, extravagant buildings symbolized the power of those who lived in them and conducted their business. As king, David lives in a house of cedar, a particularly powerful house. Cedar was valuable for many reasons, including its beauty and its rot-resistant properties. King David realizes God continues to live in a tent called the tabernacle, God's tent or tabernacle. It was movable. It went with the people as they wandered in the desert for 80 years. And then it went with them into the land when God delivered them into the land. The tabernacle was where the Ark of the Covenant was kept. It meant that the tangible presence of God went with the people wherever they went. But tents and their lack of permanence is not so much a sign of power. In contrast to my regular views of the Capitol building while living in Salem, I also saw tents. Tents along I-5. Tents in city parks. Tents near the freeway overpass and tents made of tarps and shopping carts along city sidewalks. There were, and still are, many houseless encampments around our cities. Sometimes they're visible, usually they're just out of sight to avoid catching too much attention. Tents aren't symbols of power or permanence. By the time we get to this part in 2 Samuel, when David is king, God has led the people into a land to call their own. They've been there for quite a while. They've had all kinds of time to settle down and to build plenty of houses, plenty of homes. Meanwhile, God remains in a tent, and King David intends to remedy that situation, because what kind of God lives in a tent? Definitely not a very powerful or permanent one. And what does having a homeless God say about the kind of people who follow that God? I mean, what kind of people follow a God that doesn't have a permanent home? So King David plans to build God a permanent house, because King David has the power to build a house for God. Instead of a movable and temporary tent, this house for God would become the permanent seat of power for God, replacing the tabernacle. God would have a permanent home. Since we don't spend a whole lot of time talking about the tabernacle, it might not seem all that important, but contrasting a tent for God versus a house for God might not seem that significant. But see, in Hebrew scripture, in the Old Testament, there's 13 chapters dedicated to describing the significance of the tabernacle, compared to only 3 chapters describing creation and the fall. Use of the word tabernacle in both the Old and New Testament, it takes on many forms of both noun and verb, and it occurs many, many times. Putting that in more plain language, it means tabernacle was and is foundational to the identity of the people of God. Tabernacle, the idea, the concept, the noun, the verb, doesn't just refer to a physical dwelling or to a location, like at the top of Mount Sinai, where God was dwelling, or in a tent where God is dwelling. Tabernacle is also an action. Tabernacle is a verb. It's the act of dwelling or being with someone, being with a people. So the tabernacle of God is all over Scripture, and it refers to God actively being present. God dwelling, God tabernacling with the people, as well as the name for the tent itself, the tabernacle. So there's something about this notion of God dwelling in a tent, God tabernacling, God's presence in the midst of a seemingly weak situation, an impermanent position, a tent as a building, and God is dwelling there, tabernacling there among the people. It challenges our commonly held notions of power and where power comes from. King David assumed any reasonable God would want a permanent home, especially one made of cedar, a home worthy of their position of power rather than a tent. King David also mistakenly assumes that he, as king, is in the position to build such a house of power for God. So God responds to King David, "Are you the one to build me a house to live in? I've not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day. But I've been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?'" See, God's rejecting King David's desire to build a house because God will not be trapped by the broken power structures of culture and society. God's power is different. God's power emerges in weakness. In 2 Corinthians, Paul addresses that, and he describes it like this. He said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, because power is made perfect in weakness. See, the root of the Greek verb that Paul is using here in 2 Corinthians is skeno. Great. Really, what that means is the continued dwelling of God, the tabernacling of God. Paul is describing God's power coming, dwelling, and tabernacling in our weakness, in his weakness. God's not at all interested in the house of power that King David intends to build. Rather, God flips the story around and explains that it's God who will do the house building for David. And in doing so, God is redefining power for David. The Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come forth from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. God turns David's offer to build a house on its head. But the house God is going to build for David isn't about a physical building. The house God is going to build for David is about a name, a lineage, reliability, reputation, something that will continue on to Jesus Christ, the Messiah, Son of God. Luke chapter 1, Ken read some of this earlier. Luke chapter 1 explains, the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. This is the house God is going to build." And the power of this house, this power is in stark contrast to the power of the house that King David wanted to build for God. The power of God's house is most perfectly seen through the actions of Jesus, as Jesus absorbed the violence of the cross and responded, not with retribution, but by turning that violence into an opportunity for our forgiveness and for our restoration. That is how God shows and uses God's power, true power. A power that challenges and redeems the corrupt and violent power structures of this world through peace. These days, there's all kinds of descriptions for power, commercials, ads for who's going to build a better house of power and by which means that house is going to be built. Some even claim to be building their house of power as God's representatives, while talking about their plans to exercise their power in even violent ways. Does such a house match the house we see built by God in Jesus? God has invited us to be the church in our weakness, so that Christ's power may tabernacle in us, and the purposes of God might be fulfilled through us. We also have a voice in how power is used, how power is exercised in the country where we live. So let's pay attention and use our voice well and consider those who have no voice, whose voices have been taken away. King David sought to build a house for God, because what kind of God would live among the people in a tent? Instead, God built a house for David and brought restoration for all humankind through that house. As we continue to work through God's story in the many weeks ahead, we come to work and to find our place within that story. Let's pay attention to the role of power, the theme of power, where and when the power of God shows up in the story, and how power even is abused at times by others. And in all these things, may we keep our eyes on Jesus, the center of our faith, and may God's power, the power of the cross, dwell with us in our weakness. Let's stand and sing.
About 60 years ago, I was a student at Goshen College, and Sister Mary Oyer frequently led singing at the College Mennonite Church, and she had a little habit that I picked up. So we're going to use that habit today. Number 80. And what she would do is bum, 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 the first three measures. Any of you experienced that? That was Mary Oyer. Okay.
We sing to you, our God, the rock who gave us birth.
Keep those purple books out and turn to 1043 for our prayer this morning. In it there's leader, there's all, there's also left and right. So rather than those being political distinctions, let's make those spatial distinctions. So you can be the left and you can be the right. And let's read this prayer and pray this prayer together this morning. Some trust in governments and some in borders, but we trust in God who invites all people to live in peace.
For the earth belongs to God, and all creation is in God's care. Belongs to God, and all rooted in it. We belong to one another as citizens, all of us children of God.
With gratitude for the home God has made for us on this planet, we pray.
Send your Holy Spirit to strengthen our resolve to strive for communities where foreigners become neighbors and strangers become friends. Revive our desire for the reign of Christ, who releases prisoners and liberates the oppressed, who frees the world from greed and proclaims God's peace. Make justice roll down like a river and righteousness flow like an everlasting stream. Amen. Let's stand as Ken comes for the benediction.
I've never used this passage as a benediction. I've never heard it used, but it seems appropriate. Be careful not to get carried away by the errors of unprincipled people from the firm ground that you stand on. Instead, go on growing in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory in time and in eternity. Amen.